first we'll do a come now is a time to worship. Okay? You ready? All right, let's do this. And you move us to dance in celebration. We give thanks for your presence among us. Open all points of receptivity within us as we worship you and hear your word, holy and living God. Amen.
Make a joyful noise to God, all the earth. Sing the glory of his name. Give to him glorious praise. Say to God, how terrible are thy deeds. So great is thy power that the enemies cringe before thee. All the earth worships thee. They sing praises. Sing praises to thy name. Come, see what God has done. He is terrible in his deeds among men. He turned the sea into dry land, then passed through the river on foot. There, did we rejoice in him who rules by his might forever, whose eyes keep watch on the nations. Let not the rebellious exalt themselves. Bless our God, O people. Let the sound of his praise be heard, who has kept us among the living and has not let our feet slip.
This is the reading. Join me in our prayer of transformation and thanksgiving grace. Spirit of the living God, temptation surrounds us. Self-preservation lures us to indifference. Fear of confrontation coaxes us to keep silent about things that matter. The desire to be right entices us to ignore the cries of our neighbors. Too often we ignore the call to go and to be in favor of staying stuck in our attitudes and behaviors. Too often we are the ones who refuse to welcome you into our intimate space, who resist the work of transformation, and who remain unresponsive to the burdens of our siblings and creation. Spirit of gentleness, redirect us back to the path of life, the way of justice, and the hope of peace. Companion and advocate takes this journey with us. Our invitation to make the kingdom of God our dwelling place continually renews. And that is not a misspell. Kingdom of God. Thanks be to God, the righteous one opens the door and eases our entry into new life, new mercy, and new grace. Thanks be to God.
People need the Lord.
Town is going through some heavy stuff this week. On Monday, a young man by the name of Jalen Walker, was 25. My city is a mess. And if you're a black man and you happen to break a minor violation, cost you your life more times than not. And late in the evening, he went through a red light. And before you know it, there was a chase that ended up with 10 cruisers. And he pulled off, exited the vehicle, started running. 90 bullets were fired as he ran away. 60 went through his body. There's no celebration this weekend in Akron. So yeah, people need the Lord everywhere right now. That's why we're here. To spread the gospel. That's what our passage is about today. So please keep Jalen's family in prayer and all those who love them. Lord God, we lift up Jalen Walker's family and friends, Lord, and we praise you that he is in glory with you. Now understanding what full love feels like. In your mercy. Lord, I pray for David to have showered blessings, Almighty God, upon his life. May all that you call him to be accomplished, Lord God, in your mercy. Lord God, we thank you for hearing the prayers that we have spoken and those that we hold deep within our hearts as you incline your ear to us. We praise you, not for what you do, but just for who you are. We thank you for your love. We thank you for caring about every care that we have on our hearts and minds. And we lift them all up to you, O God. As we pray the prayer your Son Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory.
After this, the Lord appointed 70 others and sent them on ahead of him, two by two, into every town, the place where he himself was about to come. said to them, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Pray, therefore, the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. Go your way. Behold, I send you out as lambs in the midst of wolves. Carry no purse, no bag, no sandals, and salute no one on the road. Whatever house you enter, first say, 'Peace be to this house.' And if a son of peace is there, your peace shall rest upon him. But if not, it shall return to you. And remain in that house, eating and drinking what they provide, for the laborer deserves his wages. Do not go from the house to house, but whatever you will whenever you enter a town, they will receive you. Eat what is set before you. Heal the sick in it, and say to them, 'The kingdom of God has come near to you.' But whenever you enter a town and they do not receive you, go into the streets and say, 'Even the dust of your town that clings to our feet, we wipe off against you.' Nevertheless, know this, that the kingdom of God has come near." And now I go to 16. "He who hears you hears me, and he who rejects you rejects me, and he who rejects me rejects him who sent me." The 70 returned with joy, saying, "Lord, even the demons are subject to us in your name." And he said to them, "I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. Behold, I have given you the authority to tread upon serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall hurt you. Nevertheless, do not rejoice in this, that the spirits are subject to you, but rejoice that your names are written in heaven."
Can you imagine? Talk last week about the cost of discipleship. Jesus was telling his disciples about things that they may have to give up, things they may have to go through, right? And here we have the next part. Still, there's that understanding of the challenges of work as a disciple of Christ. I don't know about you, but if Jesus showed up and said, "Hey, I want you to go over here and just leave your crap. Just go, girl. Just go." I'd be like, "What? Are you serious? Do I have to?" We get used to our stuff, don't we? When we think about when it comes to work for the Lord, when we think about what we're called to do in this world, and all of us have different gifts, thinking about obstacles, how many times do we focus on the obstacle of what God calls us to and miss out on the opportunity that might be happening? Right? I mean, I know if I was them, I'd be like, "Well, can I at least take the force Jesus Christ cut me off?" No. What if my legs get tired? Nope. So I'd start focusing on what I'm going to have to go through in order to do what Jesus called me to. instead of focusing on what God is going to do, if I'm just willing and faithful. And then this thought of independence, because we're in independence day, right? But as faithful people, it's more about interdependence, isn't it? We can't get anything done without the grace and Spirit of God in our life. We can't do nothing without Jesus. But another thing is, we can't do anything without each other. He never, ever, ever, ever calls anyone and sends anyone to do anything by themselves, does he? Probably to help each other when we face those obstacles. So that someone said, joy up. You're missing the opportunity here. So why 70? Well, there's meaning behind numbers in the Bible. It's actually symbolic of all of humanity. If you were to glance at Genesis 10 sometime, not now because we're worried we're out of time. But it provides a list of all the nations, numbering 70. So God is saying, my salvation is for all of humanity. No boundaries in God's world. Only ours. Like Jesus, they are told to go, take nothing. Because remember, Jesus took nothing. Jesus was homeless. He counted on the hospitality of others. And only rely, he said, on the generosity and hospitality of others. And Jesus, in fact, instructs them, going to be preaching, teaching, and healing. These disciples have the same authority as Jesus did. And the warning, of course, of conflict. We're all going to deal with conflict on the journey. Not everybody wants to go. Not everybody wants to serve the Lord. That's okay. That's quite all right. But as we go into the mission field, we might face some opposition as he relates to lambs among wolves. Right? The authority that Jesus sends them out, the power through them, because of him, they heal the sick, exorcise demons, bestow peace, all to announce the kingdom of God is near. This means having the courage in a vulnerable way, depending on the hospitality of others. As well as when the rejection happens, having a non-violent response. Because back then, you always had your sword with you. Because things weren't real peaceful back then. So talk about vulnerability. Additionally, they're instructed in a lesson of humility. For when they experience the power of God manifested in their ministry, they're instructed, hey guys, it ain't about you. Rejoice simply, he says, because your name is written in heaven. But the point of it all, the point of this mission, is to bring the kingdom of God near. This is easier said than done. Because the peace they bring, what must have happened? They had to exorcise some demons. Demons came and opposed the mission. They're just a little craftier nowadays. But don't think they don't work to go against. Often say, you'll know that you're where God has you planted when something's trying to move you out of that way. Right? Jesus also points out the importance of focusing on those who are willing to hear the message. Understanding it is God's place to deal with those who are not willing. For if this individual individual with apostolic authority presents themselves to a person bestowing peace upon them, sharing the message of Jesus, and is rejected, they're going to simply walk away. Everybody's God's people. That's not our job. Our job is to share the message. Their whole purpose in this mission is to prepare others to encounter Jesus. Sound familiar? It's interesting if we look at this. Jesus isn't the one doing work, is he? He empowers others to do the work. He sets before them a mission to accomplish. And the gifts to do the work. Remember the gifts assessment? If we say yes, God equips us. A scholar named David, but it's Lowe's, says the mission Jesus gives to his followers remains essentially the same. God is responsible for the growth of our communities. We are called to be open to this growth, to plan, organize, and work in a way that anticipates rather than impedes such growth. And to pray for and invite others to join us in gathering the harvest God has prepared. So why do we worship? Why do we pray? What's it for? Is it to get something? Or is it to give something? We unfortunately grow in this consumeristic mindset in society, especially nowadays, where we go to worship knowing we're owed something, or I'm going to go to church so I can get away from the world and what's going on in the world. But that's the very thing we're called to impact. This is where we get filled up, yes, in order to take it out. Finding out where is our mission field? But yeah, this is where we can get equipped. But we're here to glorify God. Getting something because of that? Well, that's the frosting on the cake, isn't it? But our purpose is to be here to glorify God and seek out ways to do just that. And based on our reading, that means we got to ask ourselves, what is our mission? What are we doing? But unfortunately, sometimes church can get stuck in those obstacles, right? Thinking about obstacles. It's not opportunity. Some of it's pride, when we think about it. Where's our pride leading us or getting in the way of humility and hospitality? This is a challenging question. This church is, when I was reading this passage, I thought, you know, we're kind of doing that right now. Working on a mission, right? Working on reaching people. So this church is in the midst of doing something that speaks to this very text. And I've mentioned a lot of times we've got to do something outside the walls, right? So how about it that we're getting ready to do something in August? Because that event kept coming to me as I was working on this text. And I'll be honest, when I first heard that idea of the auction and food thing and council, I'm like, first thing I'm thinking obstacles. I was like, oh, that's a lot. And I had to get out of that. Like, Joya, stop that now. Look what God might do with that. What is God going to do with that? I just got to show up. Got to show up and serve. God will take care of the rest. And from this past Sunday to Wednesday, you know I'm off Monday and Tuesday. Come Wednesday night, we had 6 people that don't come here and contacted the... How about that? We're going to meet some new people. We're going to serve some new people. How cool is that? And who knows who might stop in that we get to be Jesus to. We might be the only Jesus they see that day. I often say that, you know, you're the only Bible someone might get exposed to. So how's that going to be? Just so you know, I'm the potty pastor. That's what I volunteer to do, is the toilets. Go ahead. You go, girl. Let me tell you something. I was going to go with the Port-a-John when Holy Spirit said, Joya. And I paused for a minute. I think Amy saw a look in my eyes or something. Like, because I was arguing a little bit with God. Yeah, we don't want to do what happened to that. Yes, Joya. I'm going to do whatever God asks for the glory of God, even if it's it ain't about me. It ain't about us, is it? It's about God getting the glory. It's about us being that light in the woods. Yes? Whenever God calls us to do anything, we have a choice on how to receive the call. We can see the obstacles and say no. Or we can look for the opportunities God presents us in this call. Remembering it's about giving God glory. The reward is that in itself. Wherever and whenever God calls us to do something, it doesn't mean we have to do it alone. Ever. Ever, ever, ever. It's never meant to be like that. It's never meant to be done independently. God never calls us alone with any kind of work. Instead, we're called to be open to how God will want us to function with others, interdependently. God calls all of us to work and fight the good fight of faith, being a witness of the love and hospitality, the radical hospitality, because God doesn't just have hospitality. He has radical hospitality. The radical hospitality of God to all who God places before us. Amen? Amen. We're flipping the worship outline a little bit. We're going to do, because I'm going to be running close on time. I don't have to sing again. So we'll skip City of God. We'll move right into our prayer blessing and thanksgiving for tithes and offering and communion, okay? And then David will bring it home. Right. So for those of you watching at home, we thank you for your tithes and offerings. If you would like to continue supporting the church and be blessed by its ministry, you can send a check to 4830, see if I get it right because I screwed up her. 4836 Wexford Run Road, Bradford Woods, PA 15015. Bad about that stuff. Creator, we ask you to bless the gifts that are brought to this community and to the world. May our time be used preciously, our treasure shared faithfully, and our talents demonstrated gloriously. In your name, amen. to a time, unlike other places in the world, and even honestly, some churches. But in this church, all are welcome to the table. Amen?
Amen.
Because Jesus excludes no one. No matter how their life has been, what they've done, what they're doing, Jesus welcomes and embraces all people. And that's a challenge to be called to. To put ourselves and our thinking aside to be Jesus in the moment. So may this food give us strength to do that. When Jesus was with those whom he loved, he took the bread, he blessed it, he broke it, and he gave it to them and said, "Take this, all of you, and eat. For this is my body, broken for you." In the same way, he took the cup after giving thanks and said, "Take this, all of you. This is the cup of the new covenant. This is my blood shed for you and for all, so that sins may be forgiven. Drink this as often as you will, and when you do, remember me." Let us pray. Good and gracious Heavenly Father, we do well always and everywhere to give you thanks and praise. We thank you for the gifts of fruit of the vine and wheat of the field. We ask that you send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, O God, making them holy. We ask that you bless us too, Lord, transforming us and making us holy. We thank you and praise you, O God, that we have this moment to share this meal as one body. In Jesus' name, amen. My siblings, this is the food of God, and we are the people of God. Eat and drink for all is well. Ah, it feels like we can go have a 4th of July, huh? Let's bow our heads and pray for God's blessing. As Jesus commanded his disciples to preach and heal throughout the world, I pray that God will grant you, by the power of the Holy Spirit, the zeal to proclaim the good news of peace and justice, and gather all humanity into a life with the Holy One, our Lord Jesus Christ, and all God's people say. Amen. We're going to do this a cappella, okay? You have to join me on that. Want to stand and sing with me? I should have a choir in these guys to lead it.
May the Lord God guide us in love, and grant us peace through all of our trials. May he shelter us from harm, and keep us safe and warm, as we go along. May the love of Jesus go with you, as we part and go our separate ways. May we be more like him, with the love that shines within. Father, hear our prayer.
Your siblings probably better.
Yes.
Good to see you.
Nice. Thanks.
Thank you for being with us. Rebecca, thank you for whatever you did for recruiting me. I know you just didn't come to record and look and say, hey, I'll send you a search.
Yes.